Mr. Vice President and Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, I have the honor to present you my fourth report on the situation of human rights in Belarus. As you know, the actual event that had prompted you to establish the mandate was a violent crackdown during the 2010 presidential election with detention of more than 600 persons, civil society activists, journalists, politicians and their supporters. But in fact, the mandate was created against the background of a deeply entrenched system of oppression of human rights. I unfortunately have to report to you that the oppressive governance has not changed since the establishment of the mandate and that the violations have continued even since the close of my report and submission in April. Since I reported to you last year, the only positive developments are the release of 6 political prisoners on the eve of the presidential election in October 2015 and the lack of law enforcement violence during the actual elections. However, the lack of change is epitomized by the fact that the former prisoners, with several presidential candidates among them, have not been reinstated in their civil and political rights, and this is especially worrying before the parliamentary elections scheduled to take place on 11 September this year. Last week brought the news that the country, after considering the recommendations made by OSCE ODIHR following their assessment of the presidential election, deems the time remaining until the September elections insufficient to implement any legal changes into its election law and can therefore comply with only 2 minor items of the 30 recommendations. Similarly, even as the country took part in the human rights dialogue with the European Union, Belarus has continued to refuse to recognize the mandate created by this Council. I already mentioned the welcome lack of law enforcement violence during the presidential election. But since then, the openings have not led to any systemic change in the permission-based regime of public life that has been the main cause of practically complete paralysis of civic freedoms in Belarus. The essence of that 20 years old regime is that any public activity remains subject to prior authorization through a registration process that makes such authorization entirely arbitrary and very rare, actually. And any public activity, be it media, association, gathering, are not only forbidden but criminalized if not preliminarily authorized by the government. The legal framework continues to be based on presidential decrees. The parliament has had no opposition for 20 years now, and the judicial apparatus lacks all independence due to the fact that the president single-handedly appoints and removes all judges and prosecutors. Excellencies, the report before you differs somewhat from the previous ones. I have assessed in it the level of compliance by Belarus with recommendations of all human rights mechanisms since the first review of Belarus by the UPR working group in 2010. And my findings, unfortunately, show the absence of progress since 2010 on all key issues, as noted actually by the UPR working group last year. The country's second UPR round in 2015 has brought up basically identical recommendations and produced the same commitments as the first in 2010. in a continuing denial of the right to life, death penalty sentences not only are pronounced but are actually executed in Belarus. Since my last report, the country sentenced 4 convicted to death and proceeded with at least 1 execution. In another sign of non-cooperation with the UN human rights system, Belarus has gone on with those death sentences and the execution, disdaining the procedure that was pending before the Human Rights Committee. The president, who could do that legally, has not even commuted death sentences into life sentences due to lack of political will. I urge once again Belarus to put an end to capital punishment without further delay. It is important to note that not only fundamental political freedoms are prevented from being exercised, but also seminal economic and cultural ones. As recently as this month, here in Geneva, the International Trade Union Confederation's report put Belarus in the top 10 countries worldwide where all labor and union rights are systematically denied, protests, labor protests, repressed, and forced labor is instituted by the government. The adoption last year of a presidential decree on parasitism, tunyatstvo in Russian, which provides for taxes on all employable citizens who are not actually employed, and punitive measures against those who do not work or have a job. Such legislation is clearly servicing the practice of the government-instituted forced labor. Ladies and gentlemen, several generations have grown up in Belarus who do not know or have no experience what the words pluralism, free artistic creation, free media, labor rights, free enterprise mean in reality. Mr. Vice President, my findings underline that the current mandated level of scrutiny by the United Nations of compliance by Belarus with its human rights obligations must be maintained, especially in view of the forthcoming parliamentary elections. I reiterate my call towards the authorities to engage with the mandate. I am ready to do that even in an incremental, gradual way at any time. I am ready to assist the government just as I have assisted the civil organizations and the right defenders, which thankfully have endured and continued working in Belarus, confronting the often forbidding environment. And I would like to conclude my statement by paying tribute to them and declare my readiness to answer your questions. Thank you very much.